In Ohio, a recent Quinnipiac poll shows Mr. Obama with a 2-point lead, while the Real Clear Politics average shows that he has a slightly larger lead. Meanwhile, in Virginia, a Washington Post poll out this week puts the president 7 points ahead. The Real Clear Politics average cuts that lead down to 3. Joining us now for a fair and balanced debate, radio talk show host Leslie Marshall and Mark Davis. Welcome to the two of you. Great to have you here today.
Hi, nice guys. To be here, Uma.
Leslie, let me begin with you. The president officially getting his campaign underway today against a backdrop of discouraging news yesterday on unemployment. Even though it's now slightly lower, the improvement is entirely due to the fact that so many people have given up trying to find a job. Doesn't this curb the president's reelection momentum?
No, I don't think it does at all, because when you look at compared to years ago, certainly even though it's a small gain, over 100,000 jobs gained is certainly not over 700,000 jobs lost, firstly. Secondly, in November, it's not going to be for most voters about numbers. I mean, Democrats are going to vote for the president. Republicans are going to vote for Mitt Romney. We're looking at approximately 15% of the independents, the centrist, and where are they going to vote? And they're going to vote more with their feelings, how they feel about the economy, how they feel about unemployment as opposed to just numbers, and honestly, how they feel about the candidate, if they're relatable and if they're likable. And although I do think it'll be a very tight, nail-biting race, I'm very confident that the president will be reelected.
But Mark, the job figures show that discouragement among job seekers is growing. What impact will this have on the race if they're so frustrated with the president? But what makes you so sure that Mitt Romney can do any better?
Well, I think Leslie has a very, very good point. It's not going to be so much about the minutiae of the numbers. It'll be kind of a more organic thing. How are we feeling about the economy in general come that first Tuesday in November? And along those lines, it's going to be Mitt Romney's job. It's every Republican's job to have a strategy if the job numbers are actually, you know, heaven forbid, looking a little better. And the way to approach that is to say, still, we still have enormous, crazy spending. We still have Obamacare, a dragon that must be slain. We still have assaults on your liberties coming from this president economically and socially. So listen, I want the job numbers to get better, but I want Governor Romney and all Republicans to have a message they can use to win nonetheless.
Now, this week, the White House, in a move to win over female voters, unveiled the Julia campaign on the internet, showcasing the fictional Julia and how the president's policies help women from the moment they're born. If we could call that up for a moment, we see Julia at 3 years old, for example, and it says, because of the steps President Obama has taken to improve programs like this one, Julia joins thousands of students across the country who will start kindergarten ready to learn and succeed. And under Mitt Romney, saying that he will cut Head Start programs like this by 20%. On the other side, people who are conservative and who don't agree with this are saying, like people like the Mommy Lobby, the organization known as the Mommy Lobby, are saying that under the current progressive policies, Julia's mom is forced to work outside the home. She must rely on government-run childcare programs. Julia will spend 2 years in overcrowded rooms with minimal standards of learning, and she'll enter kindergarten at a severe disadvantage than other children whose parents had more options. Leslie, you know, Romney never said he would actually cut Head Start by 20%. This campaign is a bit misleading, isn't it?
Well, both sides have a lot of information and have taken leeway, and that's typical, unfortunately, when you have an election year, and not just presidential elections. Proof is in the pudding, and historically and statistically over the past decade or so, mudslinging, taking things out of context, those sound bites, they've worked. I don't like them, but they are very effective, and that's why politicians do use them on right and left. But what is not inaccurate of the platform that Mitt Romney will soon be standing on, that GOP that is wrapped in the color red as opposed to the blue. When you look historically, whether on a state level or a federal level, Democrats are always the ones fighting. I live in California. We here in California as Democrats, we're fighting to keep education. One of the reasons Julia's class is overcrowded is because Republicans are constantly cutting. Whenever they, you know, get into a room and say, okay, we need cuts, one of the first things they cut is education. So if Julia's going to suffer from education or not be able to have a federal Pell Grant or not be able to borrow more money for secondary education, I'm sorry, but I put that on Mark's guys.
Okay, Mark, opponents are saying, though, this campaign is showing that the president's vision. Doesn't this show that the president's vision wants people to understand that it's all about the government directing people's lives?
Yes, thank you. Thanks for the lob, and here we go. I love Julia. Julia's an opportunity for Republicans to say, hey, Julia, how about getting out of the government trough and living your own life? The thing that's going to make Julia ready for that first day of kindergarten is the quality of her family, not the per capita spending in her classroom. It has proven there's no connection between per capita spending and the actual quality of education that anybody gets. I envision President Julia, in which at about age 30, she unhooks from the government teat, becomes an entrepreneur, makes $1 million, becomes the governor of a red state, and is elected the first American Republican woman president. I mean, Julia's life can go a lot of ways. We want liberty and less taxation and more freedom for Julia, and I'll take that to the bank anytime.
Leslie, what's your response to that?
Well, first of all, I've got to say, and I'll just say for the record, if my party doesn't put the first woman in office, I think I may have to hightail it to Canada, okay? So I'm expecting that of my party, and I'm certainly hoping her initials are HRC. I'm still hopeful. But, you know, Mark, you're wrong. I have a 4- and 5-year-old, okay? I'm married to a physician. The guy loves stats and science-minded. I mean, he studied their preschool like they were going to Harvard or Stanford. And when you have more kids in the classroom, there's less individual attention. So the kids that fall behind fall farther behind, and they fall farther behind quicker. As to some of those programs that Julia, you feel, is breastfeeding from, well, they're not going to be there because you guys want to cut Social Security. You want to cut Medicare. And it's easy for people who are very wealthy or very comfortable to say to a woman who's got four kids, whose husband left her for his hot-looking secretary, who's pulling 3 waitress shifts, to say, get off the government.
All right, sometimes I'm running out of time, have to really help quickly, but let me get Mark the last word here.
Well, the bottom line is I know it's easy to paint that only the government safety net can save women who are in dire circumstances. I would say that those women, that your kids and mine, I have a 20-year-old daughter and a 9-year-old son, and their lives are better in schools that are well-run and well-managed. This notion that if funding is cut, that automatically you must have larger class sizes, not if the school is well-run and not overspending. It is better for all women, all girls, all boys, and all men to have responsible taxation, responsible spending, and let Julia and Jerry, and whatever counterpart we may make, let the boys and the girls grow up to be men and women in an America where there is reasonable spending, fiscal responsibility, and fair taxation.
All right, Mark, Leslie, always great to have you on board. Thank you so much for your insights today.
Thank you,
guys.
Thank
you.